So my question is that, like, you said that there is no terrorism in Pakistan. So I'm Pakistani, but I saw people getting killed, they're getting kidnapped. Why doesn't the government think about that? Why doesn't the government, like, you know, help them? They don't.
Thank you. Thank you. If you heard me, you would have noticed that I explained the situation in which my country got landed due to geostrategic rivalry of that time. And we suffered. We suffered. It was not our war. There was a big debate within our country whether it is our war. Until 5 years ago, there was a religious party whose leader felt that soldiers of Pakistan are not martyrs and Taliban are. It's a matter of record. Until people got together, and when innocent children like you studying in Peshawar school in December 2014 were mercilessly killed, that's where the conscience of the nation was shaken, and everybody came to it together to the conclusion that militancy and terrorism and extremism of any, and I think we have come a long way now. We have come a long way, and Pakistan has reversed this tide of terrorism at a time and in a region which is still grappling with it. And I cannot agree more with you. There should be no terrorism at all. There should be no killing. And that's the aim that we are trying to pursue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here. It was a pleasure listening to your thoughts. My question is, in the context of the Chinese influence in Pakistan, particularly given the investments with CPEC, and you mentioned the uneasy peace between China and India and the admitted rivalry between China and the US. So in that context, I just wanted to ask how you envision Pakistan balancing ties between these three countries, particularly given that often their interests in the region don't overlap.
China has been a very close friend of Pakistan, has always been, but this has largely been a political relationship. It is only recent times that we have seen the political goodwill translate into economic projects. So we have the China-Pakistan economic corridor which has emerged. We have to see the genesis of how this, because the idea has been around since early 90s. Why is it that it has happened now and not before? When President Xi came to power in China in 2013, he changed the model of development and growth in China. And he shifted from the growth-led model, which was overheating the economy to 9 to 10% of growth rates, to mobilization of domestic consumer market and developing the regions which are not developed. So that took him to Western China, which was far less developed than Eastern China. So he started making investments there. But the problem was that any product which was produced in Western China had to travel 5,000 kilometers overland to Eastern China, where all the ports were located, and then go around another 8,000 kilometers through Malacca Strait and Indian Ocean, come to Red Sea or the Persian Gulf, and that's where the idea came that perhaps it might be a much shorter route to go from Western China through Pakistan to Gwadar. The distance between Kashgar and Gwadar is 2,000 kilometers, which is 11,000 kilometers shorter than the other route. And therefore, it made perfect economic sense for Chinese to think of this project. For Pakistan and Pakistani leaders also, it became a very important project, because the western part of Pakistan is far less developed than the eastern part of Pakistan. And this route was passing through Gilgit-Baltistan, KPK, northern areas, and then through the Balochistan province. So it made perfect economic sense for Pakistan also to go for it, and we did. Investments have come into it. Some countries may not be happy about it, but I believe that in due course of time, this corridor should blossom east and west. In fact, in west, probably Afghanistan will be the first beneficiary of this, because if you go up north from Kabadar, the very first stop actually is the Kandahar province of Afghanistan, and therefore they will be direct beneficiaries of it. Central Asians are very excited, so they all came to Pakistan, their leaders, on 1st of March last year, and they were very excited because they have been landlocked for a long time, so they see this route to be used by them for their imports and for their exports. In fact, they will connect, it will connect to the Eurasian landmass. I believe that in due course of time, if our Pakistan's relations with India also improve, probably this would become a main artery for use by India as well. India has its own objections to it. India has its own equation with China and has registered with its opposition to not only China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, but also the Belt and Road Initiative. That is for India and China to sort out. We believe that connectivity in Asia, which has been the continent which was least integrated continent, is a great blessing. I believe that every avenue of connectivity should be supported and expanded, because it will bring prosperity to the people, regardless of the politics involved. The Belt and Road Initiative, for example, touches 68 countries from Asia and Europe. And I think it will benefit so many people. I believe and I hope that China and India will settle their own issues. The Indian Prime Minister was in Beijing yesterday. I hope that China-US rivalry and India siding with the United States and Pakistan siding with China, this kind of alignments will not sharpen. I hope it doesn't go in that direction. 40 years ago, when two superpowers quarreled, Soviet Union and United States, Pakistan sort of suffered, Afghanistan suffered. We came in the vortex of it. And this time around, if the same is to happen, we don't want to be there again. So we believe it's about time, like I said in the initial marks, like Dr. Henry Kissinger has also advised us in this same voice, that we need a lot more diplomacy than these strategic games.
Thanks so much for being here and speaking to us. So in your address, you mentioned that the G2G relationship between Pakistan and the United States can sometimes be strained a little bit, especially given when the governments of the United States and of Pakistan start releasing things. So instead, the relationship mostly relies on P2P. However, given the large, wide-scale rise in the United States of nationalism and a perceived security threat from overseas, how can you be confident that the P2P relationship, which appears to be the backbone between U.S. and Pakistan relationships, will maintain, especially given the additional strain under the Trump administration?
Thank you. This is a good question, because the forces that you mentioned are here in the United States as well, but United States is a late arrival to see these forces. They were already prevalent in Europe, for instance, and in other parts of the world. The world as a whole will have to grapple with them. Just see the situation. The other day I was watching this serial Genius about Albert Einstein's life when he was in Germany, and they were showing the period of between the two world wars. After the First World War, the forces of, or the concept of nationalism was rising in Germany. And you could see that Einstein and others were getting uncomfortable about it. But it was a very quiet debate. And slowly and gradually it shows how it gained momentum until Hitler came to power and he rode the wave of that. So we have to be really very careful about, and that's why I use the word narrow nationalism. Because narrow nationalism is antithetical to globalism. This world has become far too connected than to be divided again. Remember that book by Tom Friedman, The Flat World. He thought that this is now a flat world. There was a time when Soviet Union and the United States, the Cold War ended, and there was a euphoria, and and there were mega conferences in the United Nations, from child to women to environment to habitat. And there was an attempt to build a socio-economic global normative framework for the whole world. So the world was actually moving in that direction. Unfortunately, these trends are a departure from that. But my sense is that this is more of an aberration than the ultimate direction. There is a big risk. There is a risk that if we don't stem these forces in my country, in the United States, in Europe, elsewhere, then the world as a whole will suffer because we are far too connected with each other. So if one part of the body will hurt, the other will also hurt. Therefore, it is extremely important that we don't succumb to these forces. And the people-to-people contacts actually should be used to overcome these very, 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 very forces. I hope, I cannot say whether it will happen, but I surely do hope that that would be the case, not only for Pakistan, US, but for the United States relationship with almost every other country because it's a country of immigrants. Thank you. We do have